So, this week, ScorchTV vlog, TX2K16 prep. We'll be going over fuel system needs. One has to do with flex fuel to be able to handle E85, and the other has to do with the overall fuel supply to be able to handle it, I guess. One and the same. As you can see, I'm sporting the Cords performance hat, shirt. Shout out to them, new sponsor. We'll be going over the install and why we're doing it. In this one particularly, I want to cover the fuel system and in accordance to how it goes on the vet. Even more so, why do we need one for a low power application, so to speak. So, first of all, let's go over the Corvette fuel system, right? Like many other Corvette fuel systems, they, and don't mind the wind, it's kind of windy outside. So many of the fuel systems in a Corvette are comprised of two tanks with a line going from one tank to the other that transfers the fuel over, right? So in the C7 in particular, you're gonna have two tanks. One contains the pump, then there's a transfer line going to the passenger side that fills that part of the tank up as well to comprise it into whatever size it holds, 14, 15, something like that. Anyway, so you have an in-tank pump. A lot of systems are regulated. I believe on the C7, you could command how much pressure you want the in-tank pump to pump out. So normally on any application, you have an in-tank solution or you have an external solution that runs in parallel to what you have. So because the C7 is so new and there are other things that could affect, in particular the computer system and so forth, by replacing the in-tank, as well as it being more labor intensive to have to drop down the tank. It's a pain in the ass to touch the whatever that line is called, the crossover line. So in many of my builds, except for the last one, I've done an external parallel solution where I'll put a bigger pump on the outside and end up Y's in or T's in or something of that nature to the stock fuel system, and goes to the same thing that's activated by a hop switch, which I was going to show, but I don't have it here. I probably moved it. Anyway, so if you're doing an external system, you still have to tap into the tank. You still have to run a separate fuel filter, and it's either in a before and after filter, right? So you want to filter it before it gets to the pump so it doesn't clog it. And if whatever does get through, you want to filter that piece as well after the pump, or in case your pump breaks or whatever, it'll hopefully catch some of that before it gets to the engine and clogs up your fuel injectors. So, okay, so let's back up a little bit. If you run a parallel system, you have to check valve usually the stock side and the external side. Now, here's why. If you have a boost reference fuel pressure regulator, which is 1-to-1, that means that for every pound of boost you get, you'll up the fuel pressure on the external side. So this is where the issue is, right? So let's say you have your stock system at 60 pounds of pressure and your external system at 60 pounds of pressure as well, right? Let's say you go into boost at wide open throttle and through a hop switch, which means that it's activated at a certain point, at a certain pressure, it grounds out the relay and supplies the power to the pump. That pump is now going to initiate And then as the boost pressure increases, it's going to start ramping up the boost or the fuel pressure. So let's say you have 10 pounds of boost. Now your external system is going to be a 70 pounds of fuel pressure, whereas your stock system is still going to be a 60. So in turn, you're causing conflict because the external system will now begin to backflow against the pump that's at the slightly smaller fuel pressure, lower fuel pressure. So the cure for that is a check valve. A check valve is basically a one-way valve that only allows flow one way, right? So you can either put it as close to the engine as possible, or you can put it as close to the pump as possible. You can do it either way, but I always recommend on an external system to place the check valve closest to the pump as possible. And the logic behind that is priming the pump and the line when you're going into boost. That's a lot of line to have fuel go to the engine on when you're already going into boost. So technically speaking, if you put the check valve closest to the pump, that line is already going to be filled with fuel. So now you're just pushing what's already there instead of having to fill it. Because if you put the check valve up almost by the engine, sometimes the pump itself drains back into the tank and you're having to refill that whole line. So that time difference between that line being full to it already being full could be critical in some applications if you're, you know, going for bust. On the stock side, you can put it towards the engine. It doesn't really matter because you're always going to be priming that line every time that you start the car. And the pump is already going to be activated and going regardless of if you're going into boost or whatever. Being that you'll be using a check valve to activate the other line, usually a lot of people do it this way so that they don't overheat the pumps that they have on the external side. Or to, I don't know, drain the system and so forth. So this is a hop switch here, and all it does is senses how much boost, and based on that, it'll ground out, it's only two wires, it'll ground out the signal, which then in turn goes back to your relay and grounds that relay out and supplies the power to the pump. I don't have a check valve for display right now, but basically that's how it's going to happen. Now for this particular system, since we're dealing with the positive displacement supercharger, we won't be using a hop switch because the power will be coming on so quick and so fast, I already want the pump on. So we'll be running it all the time. Being that it's a smaller pump, this is a 040 pump. I don't think we'll have much heating issues, as well as the fact that we'll be running E85 on it, which is a very cold fuel. So, we talked about fueling options, either in-tank solution or external. Either one is fine. They both have their pluses and negatives. For what we're doing, that pump itself will be able to take me to a little over 1,000 horsepower or more, per se. So it will do. We talked about fuel filters, which in this case we have a pre-filter. This is what's going in the tank. It's actually a plate that sandwiches it into the actual fuel tank and seals it, and it'll be pulling from the fuel filter, going from the fuel filter to our fuel pump, and from our fuel pump it'll be going out, and this is another fuel filter, which is post fuel pump, and then up to the engine where it will be teeing in to our dedicated Motorsports flex fuel kit. Basically, pretty easy. So that's basically what we're doing with that piece. Trying to make sure I didn't skip anything. Also, our fuel pressure regulator. I always try to use something that is, you know, not a Chinese knockoff or some cheap stuff. Here's the thing. Don't cheap out on your fuel system. Use the best things that you can, because that's basically a lifeline of your engine. If you use a fuel pressure regulator and you're expecting it to do boost reference, and for some reason it's built on cheap parts and the diaphragm breaks on it or whatever, well, now when you go into boost, you're going to run extremely lean and possibly break your engine. Same thing with fuel pump. Don't use something that's silly for your application. I always try to overshoot what I'm going for goal-wise, so I build it for two times that or more. On this particular case, we're trying out this. I'm sure we'll be probably upgrading to a bigger pump or two in the future, but for now, this will do. And of course, relays. Always use one that is good enough to handle the amount of amps being drawn by your fuel pump. And make sure there's weather pack, because this will usually be outside of the car somewhere. In this particular case, it will be in the back tire well on the rear. Another thing, when dealing with this stuff, I know a lot of people are off put a lot of times by having to deal with fittings and all that stuff. I usually use Starlight hose, and Course Performance provided all this in their kit, which is awesome. They also provided some nice black fittings with it. It pretty much comes as a kit. I highly recommend it. But for this, you don't have to worry about fucking up your fingers every time you go to cut it. You can cut it with a big scissor. It's really easy to make the lines with it. I've used it in the past three builds that I've done. So I love this hose. It's a little bit more on the expensive side, but it's awesome and it's worth it. So, Course Performance, badass fuel system. On the next vlog, we're going to do the cooling side, which also has to do with our heat exchanger, and then a custom off icebox for the trunk. The process for doing this is pretty simple. You just have to drill the tank, which is a pain in the ass a little bit and nerve-wracking, because you have to do it right the first time, or you got to order a new pump or a new tank. And then just make sure that your fuel tank is as drained as possible, because some fuel is going to come out when you do this. What else am I missing? So let's talk specific to the C7 platform, right? So the limitations on the C7, the base C7, are going to be the mechanical fuel pump and the injectors. On the CL6, it's a much physically bigger mechanical fuel pump that is driven by the cam lobe, since it is direct injection, and then the injectors are different, I believe. I'm pretty sure. But even past that, the limiting factors to it are the fuel injectors, even after you do any other modifications to the fuel system. So, in turn, a lot of people are putting in cams with a 32% larger fuel lobe to run the mechanical fuel pump faster, but you're still going to be running low on the low side, which is the fuel feeding that mechanical fuel pump up front. So that's what we're handling here. So being able to supply the low side with that inherently supplies more fuel for the mechanical fuel pump to be able to deliver to the injectors, therefore upping our capacity to handle the horsepower on E85. Did I miss anything else? Don't know. But we're going to start on this, because I've only got a certain amount of hours to get this done today. Again, as always, comment. I appreciate all the feedback. You guys have been great for this new series. And, you know, any questions you have, I've been trying to get to them as quickly as possible. Feel free to post up. Make sure to support our merchandise. All the proceeds are going to St. Jude's. Make sure to give us a like, make sure to share, make sure to subscribe. This vlog series are all driven by you guys, the viewers. So if you would like to see something different that's within our wheelhouse, we'll go ahead and try to do that. As always, we're trying to make sure we bring you some different things. I hope you guys are learning from this stuff. I have a lot of knowledge and a lot of different things, and sometimes it's hard to demonstrate that. So the questions assist and things that I can't cover because I'm not talking to anyone, I'm talking to a damn camera. So it helps. We'll begin this install. We'll let you see how it goes. This time I'm hoping to shorten up the video per some of the feedback, and I will play background music so you guys don't sit in silence and in awe at how fast we're moving to do these things. So see you in a bit.
Went out on a mission, came back with a lick. I get this shit was wrong. Niggas started hating, what do they really want? Fuck I'm supposed to say, nigga fuck buying a coupe. I'd rather go on rent. I'm hopping out of the truck, dropping weed like I'm Kevin Durant. I fucked that bitch cause I gave her a Xanax and lures a pen. Burn on me every time that you see me, Yosemite Sam.
So, as you can see, we cut the hole. I'm not sure if you can tell very easily, but it's a pretty thick fuel tank. So it should be pretty good. We're going to go ahead and install the I guess, CNC bracket that goes on the inside. And then once we get that in, we'll try to fiddle this in without knocking it off the little stick. And it'll go like that. Then we'll rotate it while still pressing up against this in the back. And sticking this small tool in to hold it in place, whichever way possible, while we tighten it up. So, stay tuned and we'll see how that goes.
Flip the whole thing, it ain't nothing to me, bitch, I'll give you some ground.
Shit, fuck, flippin' O's. Right down 50 feet with my walls. Auto check, boy, they already know. Then I'm riding around with a bankroll. Hope I'll get caught around with a bankroll. Bad bitch on road day, always been a bankroll. Gucci bag on my bank, filled up with bankroll. Come right to the late door when it's been a bankroll. That's all I know. Oh, oh, that's all I know. Oh, oh, that's all I know. Oh, oh, oh.
Dame la mota y mandame a padrino. Couple of bitches I'm fucking.
So, there you have it. I'm not sure how well you can see it, but we have the plate installed. Now we'll put our dash 8 line on there to the pump. And dash 6 return. I can get it together here. Maybe I can't. Maybe I can. All right, damn it. There we go. So, okay, so we'll run that and mount our pump somewhere here. Maybe here.
Not sure yet. There we go. Yeah, so we might do that right there. And just turn this up there. It's a short line. Very short line, actually. Okay. So we'll do that. We're gonna mount the regulator back here as well, and you guys will have a better picture of how that all works out. So yeah, good times. Let's hope it doesn't leak. I'm always wary about these types of setups. I did put some seal all around it just in case. But the tank does have fuel in it and nothing's coming out yet, so I feel good about that. The other way that other people do it, let's say like A&A, is you drill into it, and it's a tapered seat fitting that goes in, and you just draw that out, and then you drill another one for the return. A little bit higher than the feed one, and that's about it. This is a cleaner install. It does have an O-ring in it, and two bolts. So the only thing about it is that you got to measure it pretty good to leave yourself enough room at the bottom and the top of a flat surface. I could have probably drilled a little bit higher. No, it starts curving there, so I drilled pretty good there. You do want to sand off the area and kind of make it as flat as possible. And then once it goes in, that's it. So we'll continue with the install and then see how it goes. Thanks.
Okay, so here's a reason I like this hose, right? Mark where you want to cut it. Take some big scissors. And you cut. That's it. I take any stranded little things and I cut them off, braided pieces. That's that. Then very easy to assemble. I basically take it apart, right? I'm not sure if you guys can see this very well, but got a little oil, dip my finger in oil, put it around the fitting a little bit. I'm gonna do this one while I'm at it. Put around this fitting. This makes it easier because this hose goes on top of this, and as you start crimping down on the hose, it pulls the hose closer and closer, sealing it. So then I'll put this in here. Make sure to seat it very well. Then here's the trick for not scratching up your fitting when tightening it down, especially if you don't have a specific vise that they recommend. Wrap it in Teflon, like so. Don't need a lot. Put it on your vise. So, tighten it down a little bit, and put your hose, start it off by hand, make sure it's in there. Just do it by hand until you can't no more. Feel it getting tighter now, So I'll take my little mark. I'll just start going at it until it reaches the base. That's it. You don't gotta overdo it. It's aluminum. You can snap the end off pretty easily. Take this off. There. Really no marks. Then you throw away what you don't use. Blam. Do the other side. So we'll come back once I'm done. This is actually a dash 8, and feeding up will be a dash 6. All right, so we took our feed line from the pump. Did I do that right? I don't think I did. Something's not right. Anyway, feed line to the pump is coming up, and it's going to tie into our flex fuel kit that I'm going to install real quick and get that done. And then this will plug in to our number 7 coil pack plug, and this will plug into the coil itself. And then this little white wire is going to go all the way across to the PCM that's in that passenger fender well. So we'll do that real quick. To do that, you need a little blue tool. Go ahead and put something here so that it doesn't leak everywhere when you do it, and do it quickly so that you don't make a mess. And of course, cover your eyes or put something over it. So in this case, you push and push forward and it comes out. Done. There's nothing there for the most part, so this should be pretty quick. So put that there. Make sure it clips in. Maybe. There we go. You hear an audible click. Take the tool off. Make sure this clicks in. You heard it click in. Good to go. So now we align that to best fit what you're trying to do. I'll massage this some more. But then you have two clips. These are retainer clips so that it doesn't pull out. First, we'll start with this one. That's in. Good deal. And you have this other one, stock one, which I'm guessing you don't put on here because there's not enough room. So that should be fine. I think. Let's see. There it goes. So that's good to go too. And it basically stops it from pulling out. No pun intended. And this crosses over and connects over there, which I will do later. Then this line should come up down here and plug in like so. Which way suits better? Let's see, I probably like it that way. So it's tightened up a little or it'll start leaking. So that's basically how it'll look for now. So gotta mess with this a little bit. But anyway, this should give you a quick idea what to expect. I want to trim that a little bit. But yeah, there you go. Ba-bam. The
Let's move back to the back of the car again. So, we're almost wrapping up with the fuel system installed. The lines already ran. Everything is tightened up. Right now, we're working on electrical stuff. So, this is the relay that will be powering it on. I am bypassing the hop switch and just running it on full time. In order for that to happen, I'm going to be commanding the same fuel pressure from the stock system and also the external system. Another thing, when you're wiring, make sure that you're soldering all the connections you can, regular solder and the solder, and shrink wrapping it. What I did with these, they already came with shrink wrap. What I do is slip it off, solder it into the actual holder, and then shrink wrap it, and then I'll shrink wrap it again at a longer length, and that should be good. So this one will be going inside the car on the Corvettes. The battery's in the back, so I'll be finding some type of grommet or something that's already going into the car in the back and taking that. The other one is the accessories. So right now I need to go look at what it looks like on some of these plugs, and then take a meter to it and turn the car to accessories only and see what kind of power I'm getting and so forth. When you're dealing with these newer cars, you have to be careful because any fluctuation in voltage sometimes for things the computer is looking for now could throw some type of code or make the car act stupid. So you gotta look for particular ones that don't really do anything as far as the car is concerned. Let's see. I think that's it. I'm gonna let you guys look at what we have so far so you can see. Let's see. Some light to it, that might help. So as you can see, everything is ran. It goes from the fuel tank bulkhead there to the O40 pump, up to a fuel filter, to the regulator. From the regulator, it goes all the way to the front, which I'll show you in a sec. And then from the regulator, it goes back to the top of the tank. There is a pre-filter on the billet fuel hat there that sits inside the tank as well. One thing that I do have to add to this is a fuel pressure gauge so that I can dial it in at least once and be done with it. Everything fits amazing. Cordy's Performance did an excellent job with this kit, and it was very easy, as you guys saw, to actually deal with it. Let's move to the front. So here, the line comes, the line comes from the back of the car through the fender, and I hook it into a Y here that actually fits directly into the OEM style fitting. And then the stock fuel system comes up to this line. It gets measured out on the E85 flex fuel sensor, comes back up and feeds into there as well. I'm trying to make sure that I capture this. Very hard to do it and control the camera at the same time. So that's basically it. I'm trying to keep these a little bit shorter, so I'm skipping a lot of time-lapse stuff that I normally do. I think somebody asked if I would do a live feed of some of these things, or maybe some Q&A stuff on YouTube or something of that nature, I guess. Leave me some feedback. Let me know what you think of that. As always, thank you for your support. As soon as we're done with this piece, we'll be doing some tuning on the car. And then
we will begin what you guys are all waiting to see, and that's some actual runs and some fun on the street, and then we'll bring it back and do some more upgrades and then go from there. It's going to be quite an adventure. I look forward to it. I hope you guys are subscribing. Leave your feedback. Thank you, everybody. Thanks, Cordy's Performance. Thanks to all my sponsors for getting these parts to me as soon as possible. At this rate, we should be ready for TX2K. I got some tricks up my sleeve, so we'll see how that goes. And look forward to the next vlog. Thank you.